controller that can always do things according to our needs. But in your use cases, usually the PixHawk flight controller will be sufficient because there are a lot of pre-built tools that are coded into the flight controller, and hence you can directly use them out of the box. And for those basic needs, you don't need to like code your own flight controller. Also, you need a modular design because you cannot fix everything of a drone into one PCB or one circuit and then expect it to perform efficiently. It becomes very hard to debug errors and mechanical issues. So a separate unit called a flight controller is always better. To code a good flight controller, you need to have a good grasp on controls theory and different controls algorithms. And also you need to be able to efficiently take data from sensors and perform computations on them efficiently. So now we'll look at a basic scenario. There are a few types of control systems that I'll walk you through. A control system is broadly classified into these three systems. There are more types, but we need to focus on these only for now. An open loop controller basically gives a linear output for an input signal. It does not care if the actual output and the expected output match. It just keeps on giving the output regardless of that. So for example, if you have a car where the right two wheels are 1% faster due to some mechanical error, and if there is a controller on the car and it tells the car to move forward with 10 meters per second, so suppose all the wheels should rotate with 10 meters per second, the controller would think that the car is moving straight, but in actuality the right two wheels will be rotating 1% faster, and hence the car will move towards the left. So this is an issue, and the controller has no way of knowing whether the car is moving as desired or not. So a closed loop feedback controller mitigates that. It passes a part, as you can see, it passes a part of the output as feedback back into the input and compares that with the input to check whether the desired and the actual outputs match. Thus, it works on the error term involved between the output and the input. And so even if there is an inherent error like the one I just told you about, so if the car has wheels that move 1% faster, it will work on the basis of the error involved, and hence it will correct for that error also. This is better because it compensates automatically for all inherent errors and biases and does not need an accurate mathematical model of the system to perform correctly. It just functions on the basis of inputs and outputs. A feed-forward loop control is a controller that reacts to an input signal in a predefined way without taking into consideration what the output is. Basically, it just gives an output when it sees a certain input, and it does not care about whether the output is actually correct. It is sort of a ballistic system where once the input system signal has been sent, you cannot tweak the output in any way. It also needs a mathematical model of the system because it needs to map the input and the output. For our use case, the one that we'll be using is a feedback loop control, and you will shortly see why. So a closed loop feedback control, as you can see.
Are you sharing your screen?
Can you not see my screen? Can anybody confirm?
Yeah.
Okay, I think there's some issue. So the closed loop feedback control. So first we'll look at our use case, which is drones. So drones are a very complex mathematical system, and modeling them is kind of hard. We need to take into account all of the complex airflows and maneuvers involved. What is easier is to work on the basis of the expected and actual outputs, and hence we use a feedback controller. As you can see, a controller receives an input signal R and passes it on to a controller. The controller gives an output U to the plant, which is the system, that is our drone. The drone then executes U and gives an output Y. And Y is sensed using sensors on board, like IMUs and gyroscopes and barometers. And that is passed back into the controller. The way it is passed back is it is subtracted from the input signal U and gives an error term E. So R is E is R minus YM. The closer the actual and expected outputs are, the smaller is the error term. And the smaller is the error term, the smaller we need to adjust our output because we're very close to the desired output. So how this translates to drones is, let's take a simple situation. Suppose consider a 1D drone where we only control the thrust involved, and thus we only, for now, we are only controlling the height. We actuate all the four motors at once and we assume that lateral motion is absent. So no XY motion is possible right now. And the only thing that we are controlling is the thrust. So suppose I need to go to a height of 50 meters using this drone, and I, to the controller, the thing, the term that I feed is the error term, which is the current height minus actual height, and that is 50 meters for now. So if I feed 50 meters into the controller, it will give me a certain thrust. And as I give it, as I give the thrust to it, it goes up. And once it starts going up, the error term also starts changing, right? Because the current position is increasing, the current height is increasing, and the error term is the desired height minus current height. So once, so it starts increasing, and once it reaches around 50 meters, the error term becomes zero, right? So here the error term is zero, and so the input to the controller is basically zero. So it should fall, right? Because the error term is zero. So this is a problem. So what do you think we should do to compensate for this? For our linear feedback controller, we were working with errors, right? And so we fed the current height and the desired height as the error. Assume that we know our current height properly using these sensors. So if we feed that as the error, it will go up to 50 meters and here the error term will become zero. So it should directly fall. So what do you think we should do? Anybody? Okay.
We have to take some minimum thrust for it to hover, and that minimum thrust plus or minus some more thrust for the drone to rise or fall. We have to take one more term.
That is correct, but that is not a very efficient way of solving this. I think Navneet has answered this correctly in the chat. So what we need to do is basically we need to keep a track of our past states, and basically we need to store our past thrust values and use them in the controller. So that is basically done using an integrator. So what you've seen right now is a basic general PID controller. A PID controller is short for proportional integral derivative. So the error term constant that you feed into the controller is called the proportional term, that is multiplied by proportional gain. Right now I talked about the past states, that is the integral term. It is basically the error integrated over a certain time period multiplied by an integral gain. So what this does is, this keeps track of past states, and thus once the drone reaches 50 meters height, the proportional term turns zero, but the integral term is not zero. It is exactly equal to the hover thrust. You can also introduce a derivative term, proportional integral derivative. The derivative term is basically the derivative of the error over a certain time period. It's basically the rate of change multiplied by a derivative gain. So what this this term does is, it kind of predicts the future state based on the current rate of change, and thus it can also account for future deviations. So a proportional term is the present state, integral term accounts for the past state, and the derivative term accounts for the future state. So how this can help is, all of these terms are, the error term is fed into all of these three controllers simultaneously, and then the outputs of all of these three is added up and passed into the process. So together they form the PID controller, and they can be used to control our drone in any one of the axes, and then you can apply this same PID control to all the axes independently, and then you can get control over all of those axes like X, Y, Z, roll, pitch, yaw, etc. So this is basically linear feedback control. We've given an input, we've gotten an output, we've given the output back to the controller using sensors as feedback, and then you've worked on those feedback again and given another output. So the main importance in PID control is of the gains. So here you can see KP, KI, and KD. So this is the proportional gain, integral gain, and derivative gain. Those gains basically tweak how aggressive the P controller or I controller or D controller is. So if you put D and I as zero, so the I controller and D controller stop working, only the P controller works. And so these gains, the importance of these gains is outlined in the slides here. I won't go into much details right now because of time, but you can definitely come back here and check these out. So I'll just go over them in a very short detail. So the P gain determines how hard the flight controller works to correct error and achieve the desired flight path. So suppose the error, this is basically multiplied by the error term, right? And if you keep a high P gain, then the controller works very hard to correct for even small errors. So it becomes a very aggressive controller. I gain determines how hard the flight controller works to hold the drone's attitude against external forces. So basically it accounts for past states, right? So if the drone has been stable for a long time and there is suddenly a disturbance, then the drone works to keep the stableness against those external forces because it needs to maintain the previous state. The D gain works as a dampener and reduces the overcorrecting and overshoots caused by the P term. So if the error term is too high, in this case, then the drone will come up to here, and then once it comes here, the error term will be zero, but the drone will have some linear upwards velocity, right? So it will overshoot. And once it overshoots, the error has become negative. So the motors will slow down and come back. The drone will come back down. But again, once it comes back down, here the error term is zero, but the drone will again have some linear velocity downwards. So again, it will overshoot down. So this overshoot will keep on happening unless you have a D control, unless you have a D controller, which dampens out the motion and corrects for those overshoots. So it basically softens the motion. Now we'll have a small PID demonstration by Atharva, where you will see those gains work in real life and you'll get a feel of what each gain does. Atharva, are you ready?
Yes, I'm ready. Okay. I'll share the screen.
Yeah.
I hope my screen is visible.
Yep, it is visible.
Yeah, so here I have this is the Unity base simulator. Yeah, so now I have entered the screen. Fine, so here we can write it, we have this following tweaker. So we have a target altitude. This is just an hover controller. So, and the KP, KI, and the KD value. KMX is something called as integral windup. So basically this sets a maximum value to KI, like the I part of the integral, because if the error at the initial error is too large, then this error might keep accumulating and it might make our code unstable. So we usually have this integral wind up thing in our controller. So let's see, if I keep it 20 and I keep my KP value to, let's say, 10, so you can see our code rotor takes off, right? And this is the altitude versus the timestamp. So you can see this motion of code rotor is with just single P gain. Harshal, maybe you can also narrate these things as I do it.
Okay, so I think for now, just keep like change the target, keep some KPI. Yeah, that's correct. Increase the target once from 20 to like 30.
Yeah, so as you can see in the, like as Herschel explained earlier, so there is this constant error with just single KP value. So like if we just use KP, then this error will be there. So yeah, first I will do it now, 20.
The constant error was there because if we only have a KP term, then as soon as the drone reaches 20, then the error term will be zero and so it falls. So there will be some height at which it will remain stable, and that height will not be 20 because there the error term is zero.
Yeah,
so as you can see, it overshoots when we just use a KP controller. Now he'll put a KI term also, so that will account for the past behavior, and so it should stabilize to 20 if the gains are correct.
Okay.
Right now, so the gains were wrong, so it's overshooting.
And basically, this is the control code which basically is actuating on those commands. So, what I did just now, I add a minus sign here. So, our controller started accumulating error, and then it went on with the error to infinity. So, yeah, sorry for that. So, okay, everything's fine. So now I will tweak the D value. So let's say if we keep it 2, we have targeted 20. So our call router will take off. Okay, the scale is not correct here.
So now this is just a PD controller. So it works on the basis of current values and the derivatives, so the future values.
Yeah.
If you could see correctly, the overshoots were corrected very quickly. That is because of the D term. It dampens out the oscillations.
Maybe I can relaunch this architecture plot to scale it.
Just keep the target as 100 or 150.
Yeah. So as our KP value is quite low, it's rising slowly to that particular data. We have KD at 2.
Now you can see that the overshoot was dampened out very quickly. Now try a PI controller, Atharva.
Okay, I think, sorry guys, I think there isn't something issue with my code, but the I controller is not working actually. When I put 2 here, so the quad rotor automatically calls. So yeah, I think there is some issue with the code. This is not an issue actually. You can use MATLAB or something, and then you can basically observe this PID gains there also. But the main motto of this demo was to just show you how actually quad rotors basically use these PID gains to actually hover and actually control their roll and pitch. I think, Herschel, is it enough?
Yeah, I think we can move on.
Yeah.
Okay, can you guys see my screen?
Yeah.
Okay, so now we know what a PID controller is, and we can use a PID controller to control our motion in one axis. So what we'll do is we'll use a PID controller to control our motion in all of the axes. And so that is called a cascaded controller. You can look up the term. So this is basically a control block diagram for a basic controller, a basic drone flight controller. If this overwhelms you, don't worry. You'll understand it in a short while. You can divide this whole controller into two parts. One is a high level controller, and one is a slow level controller. You guys can see my mouse, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is the high level controller, the position XY controller, and this is the low level controller, the altitude, pitch, roll, yaw controller. So I'll explain to you what a high level and a low level controller mean. So these are the simplest terms that I could come up with. A high level controller says that here is where you need to go, and this is what you should do to get there. Forgive the grammatical error. A low level controller says actually ensuring and doing what the high level controller demands to get there. So I'll explain it to you with an example of a drone. So if there's a drone that needs to go from here, here is 0, 0, 0, and it needs to go to, suppose, 5, 0, 0, so 5 meters away. Then what it needs to do, as Atharva said, is it needs to roll in that direction. It needs to pitch in that direction and go there, right? So what a high level controller does is you feed 5, 0, 0 to the high level controller, and it says ki, okay, to go to 5, 0, 0, pitch by these many degrees. That is the job of a high level controller. What the low level controller does is it receives this pitching command from the high level controller. So suppose the high level controller says pitch by 20 degrees. So it feeds the 20 degrees term into the low level controller, and the low level controller says, okay, right now my angle is zero. I need to go to 20 degrees. And so it applies a PID control to go from 0 degrees to 20 degrees in the pitch axis. Are you getting it? So a high level controller basically controls the motion of the quad rotor, and a low level controller controls the body rates of the quad. The low level controller is responsible for working on the outputs of the high level controller, and it controls the body rates such that the motion requirements of the high level controller can be met. So this position XY controller is the high level controller. So what it does is it takes in XY inputs from the user or from the autonomous system. So what it suppose we tell the drone to go to 5, 0. So it takes 5, 0 and it feeds into the position controller. What this does it this does is it gives out body rate. So you can see 5 and theta. So this is 20 degrees you need to pitch, or 10 degrees you need to roll, or whatever. And it feeds it into the roll pitch controller. So that is the high low level controller. This also controls the altitude, but that is not directly seen here. So this pitch controller then takes in the required roll and pitch. Roll and pitch controller take in the required roll and pitch. They also take in the current roll and pitch from the system using sensors. So this is again a feedback controller. And then correct the make the error term, and then execute the U2 and U3. U2 and U3 are basically motor moments. So it tells the drone how much to roll and pitch. And this is basically the U2 is basically the sum of the proportional integral and derivative terms of this controller. And U3 is the same for this controller, and same for yaw and altitude. So this is a basic structure of a flight controller consisting of, I repeat, a high level controller consisting of position XY controller. So it takes in position, gives out roll and pitch, and a low level controller takes in roll and pitch and gives out motor moments. So that concludes the control section. Basically, for your use cases, you don't need to actually program all of these into a controller. The Pixhawk flight controller that Atharva said has all of this already inbuilt, and a lot more functionalities, like a very nicely tuned high level controller and position controller and velocity controller and so on. So you can use those directly out of the box. So I'd urge you to explore Pixhawk, and the firmware that is used in Pixhawk is called PX4. So you can look up PX4, and another very famous firmware is ArduPilot. So you can look those two up. So that concludes the controls module. Now we'll move on to another module called the estimation module. The estimation module is basically the module that is responsible to get data from the environment and from our own sensors to pass on to other modules. It applies filters onto the sensor data and applies sensor fusion to merge data from two or more sensors. So this figure that you can see, it is getting data from a flow sensor, an IMU, and from a visual odometry module, and it takes those three data, it takes data from those three paths and merges them using an estimated Kalman filter, extended Kalman filter, sorry. You don't need to know what a Kalman filter is for now, but it basically merges those three datas and corrects for any biases or errors in any one of the data. And so the output data you get from this filter is a lot more accurate than any one of these datas. So that data is basically position in this figure. Our drone's current position, velocity, and acceleration measurements are very crucial values, obviously, and they're required by almost all the other modules. This is called localization, which is a very exciting area to work on in drones. A lot of tech teams in our institute are working in localization. So localization is basically a part of their mission, and they've implemented very cool things. So you can look them up. Techniques used in localization depend widely on what our environment is, what kind of our environment is, and what sensors are available to us. So suppose if we use indoor, if our environment is indoors, then we use SLAM techniques. And if it is outdoors, we can use GPS directly. Now you might ask, why not just use GPS indoors? That is because the GPS has an inherent error of around 4 to 5 meters. It can be shortened by using better quality GPS sensors and by being in an open space, so more satellites can see you. But again, that is still a lot for indoor use cases, because if you're in, flying indoors, then 4 to 5 meters is a very long space. So you can't have that much inaccuracy in your data. So indoors, we use SLAM techniques. SLAM is short for simultaneous localization and mapping. What SLAM does is it looks at your environment or it looks at sensor data and then correlates your current position according to your motion between frames. So I'll say that again. I'll explain it with an example. So if you're using Visual SLAM, what Visual SLAM does is it takes your data from a camera and it looks at specific points in the image. And then it calculates your distance from those points. And then it calculates those distances again one frame later. So if your drone has moved, the frame will change, right? Like the image will change. So it looks for those specific points again, and it calculates those distances again. And then it uses vector algebra to calculate your current current position based on your previous position. So that is basically how Visual SLAM works. There is also inertial SLAM. So it basically works on the basis of IMU readings. So for example, your current position is X, Y, and by sensors, you find out that you've pitched by 10 degrees for 10 seconds. So it calculates ki if you've pitched for 10 degrees, then your roll will be this much, and hence your linear speed should be this much, and hence your velocity in X axis should be this much, and time is 10 seconds. So distance should be X, the velocity into 10. And basically it adds 10, it adds 10 V to your initial position. So basically that's how you get positions using estimation. We'll move on to path planning. The path planning module is basically the wayfinder for the drone. It calculates the path of the drone based on the environment around it. I'll explain the broad pipeline involved in a path planning module. So basically you perceive the environment first. So you have sensors on you, like maybe lidars or depth cameras or things like that. And then you use those to perceive the environment around you. You get need a 3D map of the environment. Once you have a 3D map, then you can like split it in, you can convert it to an obstacle space. What an obstacle space is basically an M cross N cross P size matrix that has ones and zeros. Zeros where there are no obstacles, there is free space, and ones where there are obstacles. It uses such an obstacle space to then calculate the path using the path planner. The path planner applies one or more algorithms to generate an optimal or a suboptimal path, depending on your use case. And then once that path is calculated, it gives out waypoints. Waypoints are basically points that it needs to go through to traverse the obstacle space. Once those waypoints are given, those waypoints are fed into the trajectory tracking module. This is not fully a part of the path planning, but it merges with the controls subsystem as well. So once you have points, you need to follow the trajectory itself in actuality. So that is the job of the trajectory tracking part. It is broadly divided into two parts, global methods and local methods. Global planning gives a path based on the knowledge of the full environment space. So you need to know all of the obstacles and all of the free spaces before you start, before you even start planning the path. So like in this picture that you can see, it has basically calculated the, it basically needs to know all where all the obstacles are and where all the free spaces are before it starts planning for the path. And in global planning, you basically know the ultimate goal location and the start location. And once you apply global path planning, you ought to get the full actual path that you need to traverse from the start to the goal location. You don't need to, once global path planning has been implemented, you don't need to use it again unless there are unknown obstacles in the environment. Local path planning only works on the nearby environment. It does not need to know the full environment space, and it works only locally. So like if you basically just know the goal location, but you don't need to know all the obstacles involved in the path of the goal, and you basically start walking towards the goal, and once you encounter obstacles in your vicinity, so it basically takes into account only the nearby obstacles, and then it plans its path according to only those nearby obstacles. So you'll get a better idea once I show you some examples. So these are two common global path planning methods. So like I know these black boundaries are the obstacle, like basically walls. So you cannot go through walls. The white spaces are the empty spaces in both of these. This is Dijkstra's algorithm. This is the start location and this is the end location in both. What Dijkstra's algorithm does is it goes from the start location in all directions. It does not care where the end location is. You'll see in a while. It just starts from the start location and goes equally in all directions. And it does so until it reaches the end location. This is like a sure shot way of getting to the goal location because it will eventually cover all of the obstacle space. But as you might have already guessed, it is very time consuming and inefficient because if you're coding this into an algorithm, you need to keep track of a lot of points. A star algorithm, on the other hand, is a best first search algorithm, and hence it keeps in mind the direction towards the goal. And so as you can see, it kind of tries to go towards the goal location as well from the beginning. And that's why it needs to keep track of a less number of points, and it reaches the goal location faster. So you see it moves towards the goal directly. There is another algorithm called the potential field algorithm. So I think you might have done this in you might know about potential fields from JE. So what it does is these are the obstacles. It basically assumes that the whole world is a potential field and the obstacles have positive potential. You are a charge and you have to go towards the negative potential. You are also positively charged. Your drone is also positively charged. So the goal location is given negative potential and obstacles are given positive potential, and you also are given positive potential. So you will inherently avoid positive potential, right? Because plus plus repels. So you will avoid obstacles and you will directly try to go towards the goal location, right? So this is a kind of a very genius algorithm. Then there is an RRT star algorithm. So what it does, RRT stands for rapidly exploring random trees. So what it does is it gives out random nodes in the environment, which are not in the obstacles. And on the basis of that, it basically explores the whole environment until one of those random trees reaches the goal location. Once it does, it plans a path to there. So you can see that in some time it will get a path. So you can see that it got the path in the end. So here you might be asking that the paths are reaching here, but why isn't it directly going? That's because it is also taking into account the velocities, and all those paths that you see that are overlapping with the goal location are of infeasible velocities. So it is also taking into account how much the drone can pitch, roll and turn, etc. Now we'll move on to local path planning methods. So you see here, there is an implementation called a dynamic window approach. So the green line is basically the planned path. So as you can see, it only plans for a small area around the drone, very local method. It does not really care about the all of the obstacles. It begins going towards the goal, and according to the nearby obstacles, it plans its path. This does not depend on the current position too much. It mainly relies on the velocity spaces available. So like if a drone can go through a particular velocity, it uses that. Or I cannot explain this more in more detail right now without going into nuances. So I'll leave it up to you to explore. Also for local path planning, all of these methods that I showed can be used locally. So instead of applying, suppose A star to a whole obstacle space, just apply A star to get from here to the end of your current, to the end point towards your current view frame. So if you're only seeing, so in A star, if you're only seeing from here to this much, then you need to only go from here to here using A star. So it will go there from here to there very quickly. Basically just apply A star to a small environment space around you and not the whole environment. Local path planning is advantageous because in complex use cases, you cannot always know what all of the environment is, and you need to work quickly based on what you can just see right now. And so that's why local path planning is usually used. It can be also used for test cases like obstacle avoidances, you know, to avoid obstacles, you don't need to know the whole path towards the main goal location. You just need to get around the current obstacle, which is in your local view frame. So that is done using local path planning. Next, I'll move towards system architecture. This is basically the culmination of all of the subsystems that I showed in the previous slides. Don't get overwhelmed by all of these blocks. I'll explain them to you. So the blue block that you see here is Intel NUC. It is an onboard computer. So other than the flight controller, this is the flight controller, the Pixog flight controller. Other than the flight controller, you would also need to carry out certain things like machine learning algorithms or path planning algorithms and stuff like that. So you would need a computing body to do all those calculations for you and give out the required values. So that is the job of the onboard computer. So here we are using Intel NUC. Forget the gesture recognition and audio recognition for now. Look at this decision making and strategy block. What this does is it decides where it needs to go based on the current mission stage. So suppose it says that you need to go to X, Y, Z, that is the goal location. Then it feeds that into the path planner. The path planner gives out a path to go to XYZ. And so for going to XYZ, it gives out a destination XY. So it basically gives waypoints, and it gives those waypoints to navigation, to the navigation and control block. The decision making also gave the required values to the navigation and control block. The localization module that you can see, it is taking data here from the depth sensor. It's D415. So what a depth camera is basically an RGB camera that has that basically gives out the depth values for each points as well. So like from an RGB camera, you can see an image, and it gives out the distance of each of those points from the camera for each point in the image. So you also know, so basically you get a 3D sort of data from an RGB camera as well. So it takes that data and it feeds it into the localization module. The localization module applies maybe some sort of visual SLAM or inertial SLAM or whatever, and it gives out the current X and Y position. So destination XY given, current XY given, this navigation control block again uses a PID controller or some sort of controller that works on error and gives out the channel values and commands. So basically what we need to do, like how much the drone needs to pitch and so on, the U2 and U3 blocks that I told you about. It feeds that into Pixog. What Pixog does is it gives those into the ESCN motors, and that's how the drone moves. This TF Mini is a 1D lidar. A lidar is basically a laser range finder. So it calculates the distance from one specific point, and that is mounted below the drone. Vertically downwards, and so it measures the altitude, and the altitude is used, this module will give you the X and Y coordinates. The Z coordinate will be given using this TF Mini, and so that will give it to Pixog, and Pixog will calculate the altitude. It can also receive manual control from the receiver. So that is from us using a transmitter. The kill switch and the Arduino are a safety feature. So that's fine. This is offboard computation. You don't need to know offboard computation for now, but basically if you're running ML algorithms and sort of those things that are computationally very expensive, then you cannot run them on board. So like you cannot run them on the Intel NUC because it will take up a lot of valuable computational space that needs to be there for decision making and path planning and so on. So what we do is we calculate all of those things on a computer that we have with us that is offboard, that is not on the drone. And we just pass that data to the drone using some data link. So it does all the calculations offboard, and then the results are passed to the Intel NUC using a data link. So this is basically the culmination of all of those modules that we talked about in the previous slides. So that is how they usually work together. This is not the one-stop solution for all of your missions. This is just one of the flight structures that we've used. But you can use similar structures anywhere. You just need to understand the basic principles. Key localization gives out the current position. Path planning gives out the destination. There is an error term involved. You need to use some sort of controller to give out motor values to the controller. The controller executes those motor values and the drone moves. Because your use cases are very simple and you are beginners, I suggest that you do not go towards programming all of these things from your own using Scratch. Instead, you can use already built packages that you can just use out of the box. They're very easy to implement and they give a very good feel for they give a very good beginner feel to new people in the field. So for flight control, I strongly recommend PX4 and Ardu Pilot, as I said before. PX4 is the firmware that is used in PixHawk that Atharva mentioned. For flight simulation, because all of your ITSPs are on simulators, but in general also, if you're planning out any mission on a drone, it is always better to do so on a simulation first and not on the actual drone, because if your code may be wrong, then your drone might crash. It might also harm you as well as waste your money. So you can try out all of those things on simulations first. ROS Gazebo is a very versatile simulator that you can use to simulate your drones. I've not listed other simulators here, but you can still explore them out. ROS Gazebo is a little bit intensive, but you can also use other ones like the one that Atharva was using that was based on Unity. You can also use MATLAB and Simulink to model those. And for path planning, this is a very good link that I found. The GIFs that you see, these ones are from that link. That link has basically the implementations of a lot of path planning and localization and estimation implementations. So you can take references from those and use them in your own use cases. Also, all these algorithms that I've shown, I've not listed all of those algorithms. These are not comprehensive, but they are a good start for beginners, and you can look up those implementations for those algorithms on GitHub. You'll get a lot of implementations, and you can use those you can tweak those according to your own requirements. For localization, again the same, you can look them up on GitHub. These are a little bit involved, but I would still suggest you explore them. One is ORB SLAM for indoors. This is basically a visual SLAM, so it takes your depth camera feed and then applies visual SLAM, like the one that I told you about, where it correlates your location according to the point locations. And then inertial SLAM also you can look up. There is GPS, obviously, if you're using outdoors. There is a package called Hector Quadrotors that is a very good package because all of the modules that I talked about are implemented in it very basically, and you need to know minimal nuances to implement it. It is very easy to implement and it gives a very good feel. So this is definitely something you should check out, Hector Quadrotor. That is it from our side. Thank you. And we look forward to innovative projects from you.
So if you have any doubts, maybe you can unmute and ask.
Good afternoon. I had more of a general doubt.
Yeah.
What does Simulink exactly do?